1st of January 2013, a new year for Nonsuch, and I'm standing in Dew Pond, where the water levels have risen dramatically in the last few months with the relentless rain. The water tables are high and, as you can see, where I'm standing now, a few months ago, would have been completely dry, now full to the brink. It's going to be an action-packed year for Nonsuch, so please do join us in this new series as we explore it through the lens. This is the story of Nonsuch. It's winter in the park, and I'll be following the Nonsuch Trail, seeing why this park is so important to our country's history. And later, we'll be meeting a few of the organisations working in the park, seeing what they do and why they do it. You can also join us for a few wildlife encounters.
But first, I've got up early and gone down to the Mansion House, where there's a few strange goings-on. It's mid-December, and one person in mass has taken over the park. With those red trousers, it can only be one man. Santa Claus is coming to town. It's the annual Santa Run, and with over 200 people taking part, it's a good job that St. John's ambulance are on hand. Even if they do just end up taking photos. What's great, it's all in aid of a local charity, the St. Raphael's Hospice, offering care and help to people with cancer and other serious illnesses. After a quick photo for the local newspaper, it's off to the starting line. With a quick warm-up before they're off, on a 1 mile run, dogs, prams, and everything in between. What's great is everyone gets a medal, whether you're young or old. Santa Claus is coming to town. Santa Claus is coming to town. Afterwards, there's coffee and refreshments, just what you need on this cold winter's morning. Overall, I say it's been a great morning, and everyone's enjoyed themselves. Even if they are just a bit slow to finish.
I'm going to be following the Nonsuch Trail, so I'm starting my journey on where the site of the palace used to be. It's not there now, it's been demolished hundreds of years ago. But there's this information poster that's really interesting to read. And I really suggest, if you do follow this trail, that then you start here, as this is the best and most informative place. As you come up the road from the sign, this is the first thing you come across. It's one of three granite pillars, and it marred the outer gatehouse, so this was your first impression of the palace. Ironically, it's actually the back of the palace which is the most magnificent. But I'll find out a bit later about that. And it was excavated in 1959, and that showed us that on your right you had the gardens, and on your left you had the stables and lots of outhouses, just like Hampton Court. So, let's continue our journey.
Nonsuch really was amazing, and a part of our country's history. The three bollards now represent each gatehouse of the palace. To get a real sense of size, you would have needed to have seen the excavation.
Bullard Free lay to the southwest corner of the Privy Garden. It lay south to the wilderness, which wasn't actually untamed at all. It was a tended woodland with topiaries, stone animals, and places to play tennis and other games. So as we continue our journey, we remember that each bollard holds its own story. I'm at Bollard 4, which is the Grove of Diana. It would have included a grotto, a temple, a fountain, and an archway celebrating a story that I'll now read. It's a story of Acton, who for spying on Diana and her nymphs at the bath, was turned into a stag and hunted to his death by his own hounds. Now in Henry VIII's time, it would have been very similar. He hunted stags, and that's what this park was for. It was a hunting park. And although today in Nonsuch, we don't have any deer left, the story still lives on. I'm at point 7. This marks the end of the Nonsuch Trail, and it's been a great journey. This is the last remaining bit of the banqueting house, the platform on which it once stood. And although it's not here today, in its heyday, it was commanded two stories high, with views right across the county. And that would have been a wonderful and spectacular view. But now, as one story ends, others emerge. And this is the story of Nonsuch that will be going forever and ever.
However, urban life threatens its existence. With a dual carriageway just metres away, I worry for the future of this old relic. Without the proper funding and true love, it will fall further into disrepair, and the palace's remaining structures will be gone forever. But there is hope.
Banqueting House cellars were excavated in the 1960s, and although they had been filled in long ago, new research suggests that Shakespeare himself may have even performed here. As the sun set to the west, it was shone onto the stage, acting in natural lighting. And so, as this structure crumbles, there's still a story in it that we haven't discovered. I'm on my way to the Mansion House. Join me later in the show as I find out more about Nonsuch Palace.
Down in the woods, something's been happening. Areas like this that were once dark and overgrown have been transformed into an area like this, bright and airy. These are the coppicing woods in Nonsuch, and one volunteer group has helped maintain them since February 2011. Coppicing is an ancient form of woodland management that involves repetitive felling on the same stump near to ground level, allowing a lot more shoots to regrow. The Nonsuch Foals work here on Fridays, helping to create sustainable woodlands. And it's important to note they are conserving the woods, not destroying them. Not even the rain stops the beneficial work. Volunteer Paul explains what the group does in the woodlands.
On Fridays we help with the clearing of the trees that's been felled by John, just burning the brash and sorting out the rest of the timber for different uses, whether it's going to stay and become wildlife habitat or it's going to be recycled or sold on, used for firewood. But most of us here also have interest in the ecology of the woods as well. We undertake a butterfly survey in the summer, for example. It's just a beautiful wood, and it's nice to be part of maintaining it and help to improve it, and just thinking that the work we're doing is beneficial, and in a generation to come people will look at this and just say how wonderful it is, really.
The Foals work alongside John, the coppice worker, who works in partnership with the Lower Mole Countryside Project. The project is called Living Woodlands, and its aim is to reintroduce coppicing and woodland management in an economically sustainable way. John sells some of the wood on as a sustainable local source for just £5 a bag, or 5 bags for £20. It's fill your own, and John even supplies heavy duty plastic sacks. It's important to realise, although it looks like a lot of burning is going on, it still is beneficial. Like Paul said, this is wood that has no use as either firewood to be sold on or to be made into a wildlife habitat pile. Therefore, the only option is to burn it so that more light can reach the woodland floor. The path up the Cheam Wreck from the Mansion House is also set to be improved. The mud and bark that is there now will be transformed into a gravel path that in only a few years will look natural, whilst also providing the firm ground for easy walking and cycling, which isn't there now. Volunteer John now explains the changes already seen in the woodlands.
We're letting a lot more light into the woodland, which is beneficial for the plants on the ground. We get a lot more wildflowers coming up. Beneficial for butterflies, insects, birds that feed on those insects, and therefore it generally enriches the woodland environment.
The great thing is, you can already see these changes. New shoots of sycamore and ash are already popping up, and in the recent light of ash dieback disease, it's so important to conserve this species. The coppicing woods really show the benefits of conservation, and it's great to see the hard work from John and the Fowlers being rewarded from nature. I'm sure the work will continue to help Nonsuch and the surrounding area for years to come.
Hello, my name is Duncan Wolford and welcome to your Nonsuch News. Leading the headlines today. Firstly, a male pheasant was sighted in Nonsuch Park. This may not be such a rare bird in the common world, but it is rare to be seen in Nonsuch Park. And our very own presenter, Mark Turner, was able to catch sight of such a rare bird and then took photographic evidence of a tail feather it left behind, as you can see from these photos. It's a very, very nice tail feather. Secondly, the BMX group in the southwest corner of the park have recently installed safety barriers to protect the public when this area is in use. The Nonsuch Watch have approved of these safety barriers, and it is hoped that a natural barrier will grow around it. Warning signs have also been put up in the area. On Sunday the 31st of March, the Friends of Nonsuch reopened its museum doors for another busy year of public use. It was closed during the winter season in order to retain heating bills and to make sure it was prepared for another busy year of visitors. We've also heard news that new notice boards will be coming to Nonsuch Park to replace the tattered old ones. Keep your eyes peeled, for they will be around in the next year. In the meadow, since the first time since the tree was planted, a new shoot has appeared at the base of the monkey puzzle tree. Also, on the 21st of April 2013, the Nonsuch Watch will be holding a spring walk. More details can be found on our website. That's all for the Nonsuch News this time round. Now back to Mark Turner, who will be interviewing Gerald Smith in the Nonsuch Gallery.
I'm meeting up with Gerald Smith, Chairman to the Friends of Nonsuch. Find out more about the Nonsuch Palace. We're meeting in the Nonsuch Gallery, which includes a model made by Ben Taggart.
Hi there, Gerald.
How are you?
Oh, wow. It's magnificent, isn't it?
So yes, we think so.
How did it come about then, this model?
Well, it really came about by another organisation called the Friends of Whitehall.
Right.
They thought it would be a good idea to have a model made, since nobody knows what the place looks like. And that was nearly 20 years ago they started the fund. We came on the scene and joined forces with them to get the model designed, which is these drawings here.
Yeah.
And we went ahead at that stage and had the model made. Whitehall have gone on since and had half size one made.
It's quite a recent addition, isn't it?
Yes, this is 2 years ago.
2 years, right.
Had this made.
But how on earth did you know what it was going to look like? Because, I mean, on the trail there wasn't much to see of the palace left, is
there?
There's
nothing to see, is there, apart from the banqueting house.
Yeah.
You've got the footings there. No, what we had to go on, of course, were the illustrations. We've got some of them here. There are four illustrations of the palace that we can work off, and there are two very good descriptions of the place, but it still leaves you well short of enough information to rebuild.
Yeah, yeah.
So that was a joint effort between Professor Biddle, who did the excavations to the palace in 1959, and Ben Taggart, who was the model maker, who actually put this together.
Right.
And the two of them did an awful lot of work, research and so on, considering different aspects of the model, because you're faced with the model in actually rebuilding the place.
Yeah.
There's no fudging it anymore, you've got to actually decide.
I mean, some of the paintings weren't exactly correct,
were
they? Exactly. Artistic impression.
Just to take one example, this is probably the most famous picture that was made of the place by a chap called Hofnagel.
Right.
And he adopts onion domes on the top, which, as far as we know, the Tudors never went anywhere near, you know, there's nothing like it. So eventually, after a lot of consideration, Professor Biddle suggested that we use the domes that are, one of them's on the Tower of London, the top of the White Tower of London, there's a dome on there, and also on St James's Palace in the West End. And again, it has that type of dome. So that's the one they adopted.
Yeah.
And the one you see, of course, on the palace. The palace itself, probably the design of the palace, had a basic fault because it was wood framing with these stucco panels, magnificent stucco panels, actually set in the wood frame. And then slate put on the wood to protect it from the weather.
Yeah.
But of course, if you stop to think of it, the rain falling on the stucco faces is going to run down, and of course it'll go behind the slate, and is now carefully held against the wood, which is a recipe for wood rot. And that's probably what happened.
And there's a few features on it which are a bit strange, aren't there? It's like this fountain at the front. What's that?
We're not really sure, but.
Right.
From its position, as you see, it's right against the front. It's actually built against the building.
Yeah.
And it's possible that it actually was used as a wine fountain for entertainments in the garden.
Yeah. What confuses me is that the back of the palace is much more magnificent with these towers than the back and the front.
Now, forgive me, you are, how shall I say, being a bit lower grade than palace.
Right.
When you start talking about the back and front.
Right.
These buildings, like most big houses in the country and so on, you know, they have fronts.
Right.
They have an east front, a west front, a south front, a north front.
So there's no back
and
to the front.
That's right, there's no real back to it at all. But this one, you're right in the sense, of course, that all the emphasis was on this side here. The south front, which was the royal apartments.
Right.
The king's apartments are on the west side, the queen's apartments are on the east side, and obviously the staterooms and so on are down the south here. Nonsuch was started just at the time that Henry had been presented with an heir, the Prince of Wales, when he became Edward VI. And Henry wanted to record that fact. So the decorative scheme in the centre courtyard is one of instruction to a true Christian prince on the way in which he should carry on and deal with his subjects.
And Henry didn't really get much use of the palace, because it was actually a hunting lodge, wasn't it?
That's right.
And he died, unfortunately, before it was fully finished, so they've left it.
Probably the palace was finished, but the grounds weren't fitted up at all, so it all had to be done. Yes, it's interesting from that point of view. The decorations, of course, that you've got here in the centre, as I was saying, are things like the Labours of Hercules, 32 busts of Roman emperors, and the various virtues and gods and goddesses of the ancient world are all represented in the decorative scheme there.
I can see why Gerald's so passionate about this model. Join me later in the programme as we find out more about the excavation and the Friends of Nonsuch as an organisation itself. As spring approaches, but winter's still with us, light comes through the canopy and it gets warmer, allowing flowers such as snowdrops, primroses and bluebells to pop up and transform our woodlands. Snowdrops are our first flowers of the year, and they come in about January, but the earliest I've heard, mid-December, and they come when the warmth is just about right, sunlight's still here, and I'm in the Herald Court in front of the Mansion House, and some of these still have their protective shoots on that they push out the ground with, and then when they flower they start to lose those, and they divide and spread. They're bulb flowers, so the bulbs will split in half and then it will spread. But if it's warm enough, they can have insects such as bumblebees and even flies come in and pollinate them. I'm starting in the Nonsuch Gardens for this season's photo trail, and I'm by the small pond which is near the Rose Tunnel, and I'm going to be exploring this photo which was taken back in the 1960s by a local company. The first change I can see is there's now a fence around the pond that wasn't there back in this photo, and that's probably a good thing. It's for safety of the children
the next change I recognise is that these bushes are probably quite a recent addition to the pond. In 1960s, there weren't any bushes, and so that also probably explains why we've now got wood chip instead of grass around the edge of the pond itself. But then if we look at more subtle details in the photo, I notice first of all, there's a fountain in the middle of the pond. That's not there now, and that might be for electricity problems or a variety of reasons that we really don't know. If we then look closer back in the photo, there's a sundial. Yeah, we've got a sundial there now. But you have to look really subtly to find the difference. What we realise is that this sundial is a different shape to the one that's there now. And that shows that although we walk past that sundial and think, oh, well, that's been there for ages, actually, it might be a more recent addition than we thought. The second photo on this winter's photo trail is of the old greenhouse. The first big difference is that these urns which line the path just up here have totally gone. My sources within the park tell me that they were either vandalised and were damaged so had to be thrown away, or there are a few still around in sheds in the park, but they are damaged too, unfortunately. So now that path is totally vacant, nothing there. The next big difference is the greenhouse itself. There isn't any glass around it now. This was taken back in the 1920s, and so when there was glass, it's now gone, and we just left with this brick wall. This brick wall is actually the middle of the greenhouse, and we can tell that because there's a little brick wall at the front of this photo, and I believe that to be this wall with the slate on top of it to support the windows. It was wooden framed, and so that's why only the brick structures remain today. There's little else we can tell about the inside of the wall, but I do know that this small door here, which is eroding away slowly, actually led to the boiler room. And so in winter, when it's very cold, they could heat up a boiler and then it would circulate around the greenhouse and keep the plants nice and warm and dry so they wouldn't freeze and die. At the front, there's a potting shed. The shelves are still there today, as you can see where they would have been. And that was really important in the conservation of the garden and make sure there were these lovely plants to grow in the greenhouse. There's not much else I can tell you about the greenhouse, but there is this little wall just by it, and that steps up to the top path where the urns were. Unfortunately, we can see in this photo, there were two urns lining the walls. Unfortunately, now there's only one urn, and there were also two lions at the top, and now there's only one left. Earlier in the programme, I met up with Gerald Smith in the Nonsuch Gallery to discuss the model of Nonsuch Palace and some of the deep history behind it. Now join us as we discuss the excavation which took place in 1959 and the Friends of Nonsuch as an organisation themselves.
So this is the excavation picture, isn't it? And what did Professor Biddle find out when he undertook this?
Well, he discovered that the foundations of the palace were pretty well intact under the surface, about a foot or so down under the surface of the field, which was just green grass as it is now.
Yeah.
And opened it up section by section. It's still, I think, the biggest archaeological survey that's been done in one season.
Right, okay.
Quite extraordinary. And the extraordinary thing too is that's Professor Biddle standing there
right.
At the final feast. And yeah. He was an undergraduate at the time.
Oh, okay, so he wasn't even...
No, he wasn't even qualified.
Yeah.
But, of course, obviously, he's brilliant at his job and was recognised, of course, at the time.
He must have been.
It was somebody like Sir John Sunson who chose him to do the job.
And so, There wasn't much to see, was there? But they did find out a few key points about water and drainage.
There was nothing to see, in actual fact, as I was saying. They had to open it all up. And then, of course, they discovered, as you're saying, that it had a main drainage system of sorts, in that in the case there, you can see the bottom row, there's what appears to be almost a corridor.
Yeah.
But that actually is the main drain, that's the size of the main drain.
Okay.
It's a metre across and roughly a metre and a half
so
wide.
So they were quite sophisticated then?
Yes, yes. The water system started on Howell Hill,
yes,
which is above
this
property here. So the water came from a pure spring out there and then was brought in conduit down to the site here and then up to those towers at the end. The water was taken up there. There were tanks in the tower where the water was stored. And then, of course, from the tanks, you took pipes to anywhere you wanted in the palace.
It was gravity fed, wasn't it?
That's right, yeah.
You
need only be gravity fed. The advantage, too, was that you could actually work fountains.
Yes.
Because once you released it, it tries to find its own level again.
Yes, quite clever.
Yes. And the other side as well, once you filled your tanks, of course, the water's flowing on from the stream, so what do? You conduct it down and through your main drain, so you're purging your main drain with water all the time.
Yeah,
and hopefully you're getting rid of all the nasty stuff that goes down to the main drain.
And Professor Biddle did find some stucco panels, and you've also found some, haven't you?
Yes,
parts of some.
Quite extraordinary, yes. The most that was ever found of one panel, and remember there are something like 700 panels around the palace, but the only one, the most that was found was there, that's a photograph of the bits, and in the top left hand corner is an artist's representation of what it looked like.
Right.
So, yes, it was a great loss, of course. The real reason, by the way, that we lost everything was that it could be broken up and burnt for lime for the iron founders in Sussex, just over the border.
Same.
And, of course, my lady, wanting money, sold the lot, of course. And none of it was left. It was a true tragedy on certainly European scale. And, we lost an art treasure that was quite terrible, really. But it's no good crying about it now.
And now, the Friends of Nonsuch, the organisation, the great organisation that you are, you don't get any funding, do you?
Oh, no. We started up. Really, we started up as concern for the park as it is now, and of course the Georgian house, which stands still stands in the park,
mansion
happily,
house, yeah.
The mansion house. But our long term must be for some recognition of the palace.
Yes.
As I was saying to you earlier, we were preceded in this by the Friends of Whitehall, who were also interested in exactly the same thing.
Mm.
So it was inevitable that once we secured, well, we hope we secured, the mansion and got it on a better footing, then we would concentrate on the palace and do something about that.
Yeah.
And the best thing for the palace, really, was to try our best to make a model of it.
Right.
I mean, technically speaking, rebuild it would have been nice, but the next best thing is a model, and that's what we did. As you pointed out, we don't have any public money at all. It's all been raised by public coming in and seeing our museum, and we used to run a jazz night in the garden, which raised a few thousand pounds, and we had small entertainments and also bring in a bit at a time, But it all adds up, that's the great thing.
And you mentioned the museum, because the gallery isn't the only thing that you run, is it? No, you also have a museum in the Mansion House.
Yes, the service wing of the mansion has been refitted in very nearly the same style as it would have been used in the principally the Victorian age.
Right.
And that's open, of course, in the summer. The model here we've had open right the way through the winter.
Yeah.
Every Sunday, but now we're about to open the museum again. But the model, of course, will carry on being viewed at the same time.
And you've still got some of the original features, don't you?
Yes, oh yes, that's the main thing of the museum. We've got all original features there.
Yeah, wonderful.
I really do suggest coming down here one day to explore Nonsuch's history. Both the palace and museum are wonderful, and there's helpful and knowledgeable stewards on hand to help out. Plus, members and children under 16 get free entry.
Hello, Mark.
Oh, hi there, Duncan. How are you?
I'm good, thank you. How are you?
I'm brilliant, yeah. Lovely day.
What are you doing at the moment?
I'm just doing a bit of spot of bird watching.
What kind of birds are you looking out for?
Well, I'm especially looking at the Indian ringnet parakeets.
Indian ringnet parakeets? Well, I haven't really heard about them. Could you tell me a bit more about them?
Okay, well, they come from Asia, Africa originally, and there's quite a few theories of how they come out and spread into the southeast. And Nonsuch is lucky enough to be in the top 10 destinations for parakeets.
Top 10?
To see them, yeah. And they're actually now in the top 20 most seen birds in London.
I'm surprised I haven't heard of them then. So if I was coming to Nonsuch Park and I wanted to look out for these birds, what would be the more defining features that could tell me that's an Indian ringnecked parakeet?
Well, firstly, it's not to look, it's to listen. If you're coming along a path or something, you'll hear this cautious cry, and it's really quite loud, and because they're gathering in large groups, there'll be lots of them crying out at once, all calling to each other. And so once you've heard them, you know they're in the area, and you can go towards the sound, and you might see a few of them darting across the fields. And they're quite colourful birds. They've got a red beak, a green chest and body, and a yellow tail. And so they're quite easy to spot, especially on a dull day.
Ah, okay. So what would be the best place, you'd you say, to look at these birds in the UK?
Well, the best and most popular route in amongst parakeets is East Rugby Club. But what we find is that as we enter end of spring, end of winter, and then start of spring, the females will start nesting, and they won't go to the roost sites anymore, only the males will go. And that does give us some information about how many breeding pairs there are. But so I'd say winter is probably a good time to see them, as they do come in large numbers. And I think Nonsuch is quite a good place to see them as well, especially as it's on your doorstep.
Parakeets are such an easy bird to sex. The males have a black ring around their neck, hence the name, and a red collar slightly above. The females and juveniles won't have these features, and so making the research into these foreign visitors just that touch easier. Parakeets are one of our most colourful birds in our country, but there's a mystery to how they arrived in Britain. From the stories of them escaping from a set of the African Queen to Jimi Hendrix releasing them from his girlfriend's bedroom, this mystery will almost certainly stay unknown. But that doesn't matter when they bring a flash of colour to your day. The ringneck parakeet is one of the earliest birds to mate and nest, often starting in the later months of winter. At the top of Hillfield, love was in the air, and here we see a submissive female to the male which will support and care for her during the rearing process. Eventually, they made up their minds. The guests, as you see, are actually in fact part of courtship, and it's not kissing but more grooming, especially in areas difficult to get at around the beak. Although not everyone found love today, I soon see increased activity around a nest hole in a tree. As I take a closer look, movement can be seen from inside. I'm really happy to see a parakeet already preparing a nest for the young. But then, not a parakeet, but a green woodpecker appears at the entrance hole. This vital footage shows that not only do parakeets use old woodpecker holes, but it seems they attack the species inside whilst they're still using it. What's ironic is the woodpecker has a red band on its head, a green body, and a yellow tail. However, the parakeets soon leave them alone, and the task of nest building begins. I'm sure these two woodpecker parents will battle through the nesting season and come through successful.
That's all for this season's programme. Join us next time as we discover the park during spring. We hope you've enjoyed it. Goodbye.